I wrote our first website, and when I wrote it, I started off with the Rebirth of Cigars. And luckily, smartly, I trademarked that. So that's become our company ethos. Is really, that's our, not just what we say, it's not a slogan that we use for marketing only. It's really, really what set us apart from everybody else at that time. And that Rebirth of Cigar ethos was really something that we have followed through with, you know, to our core. And I think to start off, having Pedro give you guys a little bit of an overview of tobacco. Some of you know almost everything he said. I even learned something on from what he said. But each step along the way, what you learned from Mario, I had said to a couple of you guys, I didn't agree with every single thing that Mario said, but I respect everything that Mario said. And I don't agree with everything that Pepin says, and I don't agree with everything that Old Man Padron says either. But trust me, I respect everything they say because they have evidence to prove that what they're saying is correct. And we at True Estate have evidence to prove that the things that we believe in are correct as well. Sometimes there's more than one way to get to an end result. And sometimes it's hard to really determine which way is the better way. But certainly if you're a decisive person, you can determine which is the way that's best for you and which is the way you feel comfortable. What's your presentation? So before we get into my side of the presentation of tobacco, because Pedro gave us a great lead-in, the first thing I want to say to you guys is tobacco is a business. Cigar making is a business. Make no mistake. And this tour that we're doing, you guys see, I get down like the next guy. I love it. I had a great time. If we're going to do whiskey tastings or I'm going to do it, if I'm sweeping the floors, I like all part of it. Every single part of it. I like being with you guys and feeling, I almost feel like I transcend from the cigar consumer to the retailer to the distributor to the cigar manufacturer, because I've been all of that. I started off as a cigar smoker, a heavy one, and then I moved to opening a retail store at the World Trade Center. Then I became a independent rep for Nick Perdomo and for Torano. I had Nick for 17 states personally, which is unheard of. I sold a lot of stuff.
Don't forget the glue.
And I had cigar repair. I didn't sniff too much of it. Unlike some of the, sadly, some of the people in Managua. But I also then became an independent rep for Torano for 30 states. And for a company, Pheasant, at the time. Some of the companies were before a lot of your guys' smoking time. Maybe not you, maybe not some of you guys, but anyway, I've seen every aspect and done every single aspect of tobacco, except for in a large capacity growing. I did actually grow in Condega and Limay well before I was financed enough to do it, and I had to let the crops go. And this was really early on, my first year and a half living here. I got way ahead of myself. But the first thing I want to say to you guys is that tobacco and cigar making is a business. And I'm a pretty good businessman, and I think that the thing that I relate well with people in terms of our business is because I think because I've seen all parts of it and I've enjoyed each step of it. So I kind of have that feeling in terms of the excitement and the behind the side of tobacco being a business, it's a very romantic business, okay? And that's the thing that makes us and what we like so special. There's certain things that we're not the best at, and we're not growers yet, but there's certain things that we are the best at. One of the things that we are really excellent at this point is stalk cutting and stalk curing. And what we like to do is we like to, on the T52 and on the Liga 9 as well, we like to take the tobaccos, we like to cut them right at the base of the stalk, take those stalks, smash them onto the nail in the barn, and let the tobacco continue to that's why it's so oily, that's why the tobacco is so rich, because the tobacco continues, and now it's not fighting with everybody, it's just taking every drop of nutrients out of the stalks of the tobacco, okay? So that's why when you hear on the KFC, when I'm talking about the Kentucky Fire Cured, I'm talking about the mid ribs, okay? Because this it continues to give, and we want it to give as much until every last drop of energy, every last drop of nutrients are taken out from the soil and the sun and the plant. So the that's what we call priming. So back to the business side of it, what Pedro was saying about Ecuador, There are plants in Ecuador that grow up 10 to 12 feet high. They're huge. They're immense plants. And now those tobaccos in Ecuador are very different than the tobaccos in Nicaragua, because those tobaccos, and I think Mario said it, those tobaccos are grown for wrapper. So why in Ecuador do you have no shade? You don't need to put the cheesecloth above the tobacco, because the cloud covering in Ecuador is so dense that when the sun comes through the clouds, it acts as a natural covering. So the sun comes through and it allows the entire stalk to be 100% wrapper. You see, here in Nicaragua, we call wrapper is going to be called oro. That's for us, your gold. Now, filler is also incredible. The filler is expensive. Esteli filler is unmatched. Jalapa filler has its thing. Condega filler has its thing. Dominican Republic, you have different types of fillers there. You know, in Dominican Republic, they don't say seco viso and ligero. They'll say velado.
Volado.
Yeah, volado. Mm-hmm. Okay, so in the seco position, they'll say volado, and in the viso position, they'll say seco, and at the top position, they say ligero. So, velado, seco, ligero. But here, we're going to concentrate everything on seco, viso, and ligero. And when you think, you know, the basics of growing tobacco, you're going to hear me talk about rules. Rules whether you're growing tobacco, rules whether they're in the tobacco barn, rules whether they're in your humidor at the store, or rules whether they're in your humidor at your house. They're all the same. It's always the same. Why do you think people take a humidor at their house and they rotate their sticks around? Do you know why you guys rotate your sticks? Does anybody you do it, right? Every now and then you rotate your sticks, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, why do you do it?
Airflow and compression. Airflow and humidity.
Yeah. For airflow, why for airflow?
Sticks down at the bottom aren't going to get as much airflow or humidity as sticks at the top.
Oh, really? Right. Yeah, but you know what? That same thing is the same perplexity that we have at the curing barn. And it's the same issues that we go through in the pilones that we're going to go to next. What you do in your humidor at your house is the same thing that Greg should be doing with his humidor at the store. And it's the same thing that we have to do at the barn here. And that is that when we go into a tobacco barn next, okay, like I told you, the goal of the tobacco barn is different than here. It's to go from yellow to brown, or from green to yellow to red to brown. When you take tobacco, when you hang it in the curing barn on those sticks, those little they're called cujos, when you hang tobacco from the cujos, when you put tobacco in one area of the curing barn, it's going to cure in the curing barn different at one level than it is at the other. When you go to a distillery and you go and look at you go to Jim Beam Distillery and you see why they're pulling Booker's from the fifth floor, right? And they have 9-floor barrel houses, right? No, that is not the right fucking plan. That is a bad plan. It's a short-term vision. What we're going to do is we're going to find efficiencies at the factory and efficiencies within our company to find other ways to drive up profit without sacrificing the quality of your tobacco. The first thing we're going to do, before we do anything, we're going to concentrate on texture. We're going to concentrate on the texture of the tobacco because that's going to allow us to focus on every single thing that we do. We want to know how thin is that tobacco, how thick is that tobacco, and how are we going to get the very most out of that texture of that tobacco. The thicker the tobacco, the more the tobacco is going to give you. The thinner the tobacco, the less the tobacco is going to give, regalo, you. Why does it give you less or more? Because of the taste, right? Well, that's what a final consumer should be thinking. I got to think about what you're thinking about. So that's one way that the texture is going to give you more or less. The thicker the tobacco, the more it's going to give you in taste. The thinner the tobacco, the less it's going to give you in taste, but it's going to give you other benefits such as burn, combustion. So the texture of the tobacco is going to talk to us along the way, each step along the way. We're going to talk more about why this texture is important, how this texture winds up in your pocket, and where this texture comes into how you blend a cigar. But throughout the day, texture, airflow, yield, curing, these are some of the basics that are going to help us design cigars together on the production floor and in the blending session that allow us to push the limits of what we have always thought about what a blended cigar should taste like, should look like, should feel like in our hands, and should feel like after it's gone through quality control.